Hi, I'm Melody with Magoosh. I'm a test prep instructor, but I'm also a math teacher and a mathematician. So I want to share with you some of my advice for how you can get the most success out of your preparation for the quant section on the GMAT exam. Now, most of us realistically will have to do some prep work for the GMAT for a variety of reasons. One reason is that there are maybe some topics covered in the quant section that you haven't covered in a math class recently. Maybe there are topics that you learned back in high school, back in middle school. And if those aren't front of mind, if you haven't been using them, you might have to review them. We also might have some concepts that maybe we didn't learn the most strongly the first time around. Maybe your teacher was unclear. Maybe you weren't in the most focused place at that time, and that's okay. We might need to relearn and review some of the basic math principles. We also will probably need to adjust to different question types. There are some different ways that the GMAT might present concepts to you from what you have used in a math class before, especially those data sufficiency questions. It's a different type of reasoning, a different type of approach from what we may have done before. We also want to make sure that we are practicing our test-taking skill regarding the quant section. Things like the pace that you're working with from question to question, the different strategies that you use to identify a right answer, maybe in a non-traditional way, as well as using the process of elimination in an effective and meaningful way, and being able to identify when it's time to guess and move on if we're not so sure about the answer to a question. So let's say that we want to figure out how much work there is to do. I absolutely recommend to everyone that early on in your studies, you take a full-length practice GMAT, or at least a full-length practice quant section. This is going to give you a few different benefits. One is that you're going to become familiar with the different question types that you're going to see on the exam. You'll see that variety, that mix. Same thing for different concepts. You'll begin to have an idea for what kind of math things you're going to see on the exam. You'll get a feel for the timing. You might find out that you ran out of time with a bunch of questions left to go, or you might find out that being timed at all is something stressful for you. You'll learn what those obstacles are so that you know what you need to work on and overcome. You're also going to get an estimated score for that quant section. Don't pay too much attention to the raw score itself, but instead, use that score to find out what your percentile ranking would have been for that exam the best you can. That estimate is going to give you an idea of how far you might be from the goal that you need to meet. It's possible you'll find out that you're right on target to do well in the quant section already to meet your goals. And if so, that's great. Most of us won't find that, and that's perfectly okay. It's all right to do poorly on a starting diagnostic exam. There are many benefits from it, and you should not be discouraged at all if you find out that you have some work to do. Let's talk about what that work's going to look like. As I mentioned, we are going to need to review some of the content, some of the actual mathematical information that we might have learned. Now, many people think that there are some advanced math concepts tested on the GMAT. And really, most of what you're going to see is actually at a high school level. So not advanced in terms of how far into college you would be, but perhaps what makes it advanced is the way questions are framed. So the actual math concepts you're going to need to learn are at a high school level or a little bit below. Like I said, it might be harder for you individually if you haven't seen those things in a while, and that's okay. So we want to review the highest, most frequently tested concepts, not all of mathematics. You want to be brushed up on basic arithmetic, operations with percents and fractions, properties of integers, and how to work with numbers without the use of a calculator during the exam. So that might take a little bit of practice. You need to have a good understanding of basic algebra manipulation. So how to solve equations, how to work with inequalities, how to rewrite expressions, skills like factoring or working with quadratics, systems of equations, rules relating to exponents, all of those things. You will need to know some geometry, the different properties and the formulas that surround the most common shapes, including angle relationships and area and perimeter, and really a lot of rules of triangles are commonly tested on the exam. You will need to use some simple statistics, things like mean, median, and mode, things that maybe we didn't even call statistics when we were learning them in school. We're not going to need an advanced understanding of college-level statistics. There are definitely more concepts than this that can be tested, but I recommend focusing on the most frequently tested concepts to build a really solid foundation for yourself. And if you find you've got them all under your belt and you can still improve your score some more by adding the more rare concepts tested on the GMAT, then great, go ahead and add those, but make that a later priority in your studies. Now, once we've got those concepts in mind, the most important part of your preparation is going to come from realistic practice. So you want to practice with high quality practice problems that come from the test makers themselves or from reliable sources like the problems that you can see in Magoosh. At first, you might want to practice in an untimed way. Let yourself have all the time you need to really work out a question, apply strategies, find the correct answers the best you can. And then as time goes by, you should start adding a timed element more and more. Little by little, your pace on questions should naturally improve as you become more comfortable, but working with timing is very important in order to complete the sections on the exam within the time allotted on the clock. Now, all the practice in the world isn't going to do that much for you unless you learn from that practice. So you need to review your practice. If you're not doing this, then that is the biggest gap in your test prep, not just for quant, but for everything that you're learning. Whenever you practice a problem, you want to be able to go back. If you're just working on individual problems, do it then. If you're doing a full-length section or a full-length exam timed, come back and review every problem. If you got it right and you knew exactly what you were doing, that's great. If you got it right and it was an accident, you guessed, then you might need to learn what was the gap in your understanding or what step did you not do right. If you got it wrong, did you make a small calculation error? Were you missing some concept knowledge? Did you misread or fall for a trap built into the question? Once you've got that information, I recommend using an error log to record the mistakes that you're making. It could be that you just need to learn more about the topic. It could be that there are certain errors, certain mistakes that you tend to make personally more often. You can check out our GMAT blog for a great example of an error log with a template that you can download and use for yourself. Learn what patterns there are to the wrong answers you're getting, and that will be a very powerful tool in helping you to benefit from all the practice that you do. Another point that I always make sure to tell my students is that there are, in fact, many different ways to get a right answer on any math concept. A lot of times in formal math classes, our teachers don't like that. They might want you to learn only one specific way. But the reality in mathematics is that there are many, many correct ways to find an answer. So I suggest experimenting, going about the test in a few different ways. You might learn some strategies that you can substitute for the traditional or more formal way. For example, do I want to solve this problem using an algebraic equation? Or what if I tested out what's in the answer choices to see if those solve the problem? There might be different strategies you can use. There are different approaches, and I encourage you to try them all. Work out the same problem two or three different ways if you see different approaches, and figure out which strategies are the most effective for you. That really truly varies from person to person. So we can't tell you what the best strategy is. We can provide you options, and you have to test out what's best for you. What's best for you is, of course, going to be giving you accurate, correct answers as reliably and as often as possible. It's also going to feel more logical and more clear to you than something that you personally would find a little bit more confusing. You're going to want to look at which methods, which techniques are helping you to find the answers quickly as possible and with the lowest amount of stress. You want to look for which ones will help you to avoid small calculation errors that could lead to wrong answers. The best method for you is going to make you have the smoothest, most successful experience on test day with a high percentage of questions that you can work through comfortably and do your personal best. Finally, going back to that concept of learning from your mistakes, as you review your error log, as you look at patterns of mistakes, you're going to figure out some concepts that you need to relearn or remember that might be different from another person. You're going to figure out what mistakes you're most likely to make. And you want to use that to personalize your studies, to focus on the areas that will fill in the gaps in your personal performance on the GMAT quant section. It's a good idea to start with the lower difficulty areas where you personally have weaknesses in your performance and build your way up to harder and harder concepts and question types as you go. Finally, know when to stop. You should have a score goal in mind and be satisfied with stopping when you've reached that. You hopefully will reach a level where you're performing consistently around the score that you're going to need to reach on exam day. And beyond that, improvement might be satisfying, but isn't necessarily the best use of your time and your energy. Try to get to a point where you can consistently sustain a score that you will be very happy with, and then you will know that you're getting close to ready to take the actual exam. So we've discussed a lot of different concepts here, and it's not necessarily that you want to do a bunch of different steps in order, but if you consider all these components, you apply them to the way you study, what you study, and the methods that you're using, then those will work together to help you be prepared and feel prepared and confident, ready for the quant exam on the GMAT. So go ahead, get started in your practice if you haven't yet. Apply these tips, and I can't wait to see how well you do on the exam.